Mér er alltaf fundist saga þessa ríkisstaldir ráðgáta og ein af allra bestu bókunum sem ég lesið Austur-Þýskaland, Þýska alþýðulýðveldið, heitir Stasiland og eftir Önnu Funder sem reyndar frá Ástralíu. Og hún hér stödd af því að bókin hennar komin út á íslensku, Stasiland, sögur af fólki handan Berlínamúrsins. Welcome, Anna Funder. I was telling the audience that in fact this is one of the best books I have ever read about the DDR, the Deutsche Demokratische Republik, because you get a feel of how people lived within the wall and with this sort of constant oppression.
Yes, well, that's very kind of you. My interest was really in what it felt like to live in that regime and what it felt like for ordinary people. But when I started to look at it, the people that I found that most interested me had somehow come up against the state. So they became, even if they didn't want to, they became dissidents of one kind or another. So one young girl who tried to climb the Berlin Wall, and one housewife who tried to get out to get to her baby, the alcoholic rock star Klaus Renft, and so on. They were the people who really interested me. And I thought I was looking at ordinary people, but I ended up looking at what is extraordinary about people mm-hmm. who will always resist an unjust regime.
Yes.
And that really fascinated me. Then, of course, I had to go and talk to, I felt I should go and talk to some Stasi men as well. And when I was writing the book, it was in the mid-90s, and I was told, no one will talk to you.
Yes.
The Stasi have completely disappeared. So I advertised for them. I took an advertisement in the personal columns of the newspaper in Potsdam, where many, many ex-Stasi lived.
Yes.
And I wrote, Australian writer seeks Stasi men for conversation, you know. And my phone just rang and rang and rang. Yeah.
And they really wanted to talk.
At that time, they really wanted to talk.
Yes.
And they wanted never for their names to be used.
No.
Sometimes they wouldn't tell me their names. But really what they wanted was to explain to someone who they thought was not biased against them about the virtues and the wonders of socialism. And one of them actually gave me a copy of the Communist Manifesto and handed it to me with great ceremony and said, now in Australia you might sow the seeds of socialism there.
And they were still meeting in these bars and
well, they were still, so this is after the wall has fallen, and they are you know, really they were frightened, I think, of being attacked by people that they had interrogated, for instance, or that there would be lawsuits against them. And basically there was very little action against most of the Stasi, a few of the higher-ups and a couple of the border guards. But really most of them, contrary to popular belief, went on to very good jobs, much better jobs than the people that they oppressed.
Then there's also this figure who is almost comic, Karl Eduard von Schnee.
Yes.
Which is, that's a very funny story, actually.
Well, yes, he was one of the, he wasn't actually Stasi, he was more like you. He was he was the face of the East German state on television.
Yes.
I don't know if that's like you or not. I've just arrived in Reykjavik. But his job was to, because in the later decades of the regime, East Germans could watch West German television. They could watch West German news, they could watch Dallas, they could watch all this very capitalist, imperialist material. So Karl Eduard von Schnitzler's job was to have a show which poured scorn on all of those programs, or which pointed out, sometimes justifiably, problems in the West as problems of capitalist problems, unemployment, or prostitution or drug addiction or something. But he was really very widely hated. People called him Filthy Ed, you know. They hated him, and every time his program would come on, they didn't have remote controls in those days, but they would all rush to the television to turn it off. So he became known as Karl Eduard von Schnitt, because that's as far as he could get with his introduction before he would be turned off.
But your main protagonist of the book is actually this this woman, Miriam, who sort of accidentally becomes a, gets into trouble with the government, and she's always in trouble from that day on.
Yes, that's right. So if you're looking at the Stasi, we're looking at a regime where, by CIA estimates, one person in seven was informing on their family, friends, colleagues, you know, teachers on children and neighbours on one another and so on. So the way that the socialist regime kept control was to keep everybody in fear, essentially of one another.
Yes.
So that you couldn't speak out because you might be told on to the authorities, and then something would happen to you. You wouldn't know why, but you wouldn't get a job, or you wouldn't get into the university, or you would be imprisoned and taken off the street. And these things happen to people. Miriam was a schoolgirl in 1968 when the authorities destroyed a very beautiful church in Leipzig called the Universitätskirche. And she and a friend made little handmade leaflets and glued them up around town saying, "We think the government should consult us before destroying our cultural heritage." Anyway, they were arrested, these children, and put on remand for a month in solitary. And then when they were released, Miriam decided, I think she was quite a hothead, she decided that she was just going to leave, and she went to Berlin and tried to climb the wall. That was the story I thought I was going to be telling when I met her. But the actual story was much more a story about her whole life and what that does to you to be in a Stasi prison from 16 to 17 and a half. And then subsequently what happened to her and her husband. How is it that someone can have the moral strength to continually say, "I just don't care what you do to me, I am not going to collaborate with
you." Her husband was killed, actually.
Her husband was killed, a young man killed in Stasi custody. And the Stasi refused to say how this happened. And then they effectively orchestrated the funeral. So, you know, she went to one funeral parlor, she's now in her 20s, and they say, "Oh, we weren't expecting you. You are meant to go to this other funeral parlor." And that's where the Stasi have the plans for burying this body that they have been responsible for the death of this person, and they do that. So, but Miriam was a very funny woman. I mean, obviously it's black humor. But in order to survive psychologically in those circumstances, I think you probably have to have a sense of humor, even if it's very, very dark.
You feel great sympathy for her. Where is she now?
Well, I last saw her recently in May. She lives in Leipzig still.
Okay.
And she works at, again, I hate to bring it back to you all the time, but she works at the state radio station. But ex-Stasi informers are her bosses in public radio. So they are very concerned. For instance, when the 20th anniversary of the fall of the wall in 2009, when there were peaceful marches to celebrate the fall of the wall, the dissidents, the former dissidents at the radio station, were rostered on to work so that they could not go and commemorate the fall of the wall, while the Stasi men, who are her bosses still, went and walked with the candle in the demonstration to celebrate the 20-year anniversary of the wall. But Miriam says to me, "You know, actually, in a way, that's okay, because they were there 20 years ago. They were there among us as informers. And now they've gone back."
These are small ironies.
They're small and large ironies.
Small and large ironies. Yes. But you are also, you are, of course, there are some years since this great book was published, and you have another book, a more recent book, which has been winning prizes, and but it also happens in, it's also in Europe, it's also in, in Germany.
Yes. My latest book is called All That I Am, and it's a novel, but it's based on true stories of some, I knew one of these women, because she ended up in Australia, of very early anti-Hitler activists. So it's set back in the previous dictatorship in Germany. And it's about these four people who have very glamorous journalists and writers in Weimar Berlin, and as soon as Hitler comes to power, they have to flee, and they go to London, where they think they're safe, but they're not. And what people don't realize really is that those who had to flee Hitler in the first instance were those who spoke out against him, and that Hitler immediately sent Gestapo assassins to London, to Czechoslovakia and elsewhere to try and chase them down. And my novel is about what happened to these people in Bloomsbury who were trying to alert the world to what Hitler was doing. And what happened to them, they are real people. What happened to them really happened. And I've written a novel that basically explores what it feels like to be so brave and what it feels like to be so afraid.
Well, we have the subject of this book.
It's, yes, I have one subject.
Okay, thank you. It's a pleasure having you on this program, Anna von der. Thank you.
Thank you very much.